There is a story about a little boy that was coming home from a little league game. He opens up the door, and his dad was not able to attend the game. And so his dad asked him, he says, so how'd you do, son? And the little boy says, you won't believe it. I was responsible for the winning run. Really? Asked his dad. How'd you do that? And said the little boy, I dropped the ball.
Yeah.
Responsible for the other team. Let me tell you this story. Okay. Back in 1990, actress Michelle Pfeiffer was in a parking lot of a movie studio when she went to open up a car door with her keys, and the car wouldn't open. And so in frustration, she began to beat on the window of her car with her shoe and stopped when all of a sudden a studio exec came out and said, what are you doing hitting my car? And the embarrassed actor realized that her car was the same make, the same model, the same color as his. And so, very embarrassed, she got out a pen, autographed her shoe, gave it to the studio executive, and walked on looking for her own car. Some of you might say, well, it sounds like some first world problems. But it really gets to the point that life can be hard sometimes. My wife and I are always on the lookout for really funny comedians. And I can tell you that is hard because so many comedians, they talk about sex and mean women jokes and four-letter words. And finding someone who has clean humor and is funny at the same time can be a challenge. So I'm going to recommend someone to you. His name is Gary Goldman. And I first heard this very funny comedian when he gave this wonderful take on about how states got their abbreviations. Very, very funny. But recently he's come out with a new special, and it's on HBO, so the only way you can watch it is if you have HBO. But before the show starts, there's a disclaimer. And it says they're going to be talking about depression. And then as the show continues and he begins to spiel, you realize just how honest and frank he is about sharing in the struggles of his mental illness. And at the same time, he's really funny about it. And probably the most meaningful thing, at least for me, took place right at the end. He talks about how he's better now, that he doesn't think about suicide every day, and for the most part, he's able to get out of bed. He's able to iron his clothes. He's able to eat. And then he says, life is better now. I'm not cured. Things are still hard. And then the zinger. Life. You got to do it every single day. Think about that one. Every single day. Life is hard. When you don't want to go to work. When you don't want to go to school. When you don't want to face that neighbor you can't stand. When you don't want to face your boss. When you don't want to open your mail because you have bills that you can't pay. When you don't want to take that certain phone call. It's tough. There are certain days when you certainly don't want to get out of bed. You don't want to face your health crisis. You don't want to take your medications. Or you're staring down and realizing that life is not getting better, it's getting worse. This is life. And when you make it through one day, you realize you got to do it all again tomorrow. Now, for Gary Goldman, he says in his special, he says what got him through it was a counselor who was trying all kinds of different therapies to help him out. Also, a spouse. His spouse was so wonderful to be with him at some very tough times. And then he admits probably the thing that really clinched it for him was when he checked himself into a psych hospital. And he had some very funny anecdotes about that. He says that the hospital helped him regulate his medicine, but also reminded him that he was not alone. That there are others who are struggling with the same concept of life. And that he had to and they have to face it every single day. So this is where we are this month, facing life in a sermon series that we're calling What is Church? It's a sermon series defining this place. Last month was our dream month, and I shared with you four things that were on my mind, and we talked about what was the vision that you had for this place that we love. And so now we put some substance to it. You see, visioning is one thing, but living life, I mean, that's something that we've got to do every single day. And this month, we're going to be looking at the Apostle Paul. Because every early church letters were and still are the definition of what church is and what church should be. So let me ask you this question. What's the first thing that comes to mind when I ask this question, what is church? A building, right? Or maybe you're thinking of a specific building. Or maybe you're thinking of a certain section of a building. But we all know churches that do not meet in a building. Maybe your mind went to a denomination. But we all know some churches that are not connected to denominations. So I decided to go to the internet to find this answer out. And that's certainly where the millennials and our children go for answers. And now the internet is not always correct, but I can tell you this time it was spot on. I just went to the internet, I said, what is church? And here was the answer. Many people today understand the church as a building. This is not a biblical understanding of the church. The word church is a translation of the Greek word ecclesia, which is defined as an assembly or called out ones. The root meaning of church is not that of a building, but of people. It is ironic that when you ask people what church they attend, they usually identify a building. Romans 16:5 says, greet the church that is in their house. Paul refers to the church in their house, not the church building, but a body of believers. So what is church? Well, church cannot exist without you, and church cannot exist without me, and church cannot exist without the body of believers. And so that leads us to the word encouragement, a word so important to the body of believers that when Paul writes his second letter to Thessalonica, he begins with a word of encouragement. Max, would you read it for us, please?
Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians, in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We must always give thanks to God for you, brothers and sisters, as is right, because your faith is growing abundantly, and the love of every one of you for one another is increasing. Therefore, we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your steadfastness and faith during all your persecutions and the afflictions that you are enduring. This is evidence that the righteous judgment of God and is intended to make you worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are also suffering. For it is indeed just of God to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to give you relief to the afflicted as well as to us, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven and his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. These will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction, separated from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might, when he comes to be glorified by his saints and to be marveled at on the day among all who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. To this end, we always pray for you, asking that our God will make you worthy of his call and will fulfill by his power every good resolve and work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ.
So, why these encouraging words? I mean, what is going on in the life of an average Thessalonian? Well, let me share with you what one scholar said about this passage. Today's epistle recalls how early church communities were forced to face the persistent possibility that they might suddenly find themselves part of Rome's permanent Christian witness relocation program. In periodic fits of pluralistic ethno-religious cleansing, various emperors ordered, or simply allowed, cruel and violent purges of philosophically annoying religious sects, especially one particularly peculiar sect called Christians. One didn't even need to be a very good Christian to raise Rome's ire. Despite this, the Thessalonian Christians faced the danger of uncertainty, of bearing the name of Christ with grace, courage, and good spirit. Paul was delighted to be able to boast about the witness of these saints, although they face persecutions and afflictions. The Thessalonians have become mirrors of Christ's own glory by growing in faith, increasing in love, and enduring with steadfastness. You know, what these early Christians are facing certainly puts my problems and struggles into perspective. Something that I called earlier in this sermon, first world problems. Some of you have probably seen the memes of first world problems. These are things that people in the first world, they say them, and then you realize it pales to what the third world is going through. So here's a top six list of, I found, of first world problems. Slow internet speed. Bad tasting fruit. Getting a bad haircut. Losing the TV remote. Phone battery dying, also known as low battery anxiety. Or misplacing wireless AirPods. And I'm going to add a seventh one here in Nebraska. The possibility we'll have a losing season. So, okay, you had to add that. Now, I want you to know, I'm not trying to trivialize the pain and struggle of every day. In fact, just by waking up this morning and realizing that you have aches and pains proves something. So, let's see. How many of us woke up this morning with some aches and pains? I'm going to tell you something. It just proves that you're alive. You made it through another day. And yesterday was hard, but you made through it. Made it through it. Ken Blanchard talks about a remembrance of a friend of his by the name of Norman Vincent Peale. And he had this to say about Norman. I first met Norman in July 1986. Larry Hughes, who was president of my publishing company, had suggested that we think about writing a book together on ethics. We decided to do that, and the next 2 years working with Norman on the power of ethical management was one of the greatest delights I had ever had in my life. Ever since that first meeting, Norman had a great impact on my life. He always contended that positive thinkers get positive results because they're not afraid of problems. In fact, rather than thinking of a problem as something that is negative and ought to be removed as quickly as possible, Norman felt problems were a sign of life. To illustrate that point, here is one of his favorite stories, one I have used frequently in my presentations. So this is a story that comes from Norman Vincent Peale. One day I was walking down the street when I saw my friend George approaching. It was evident from his downtrodden look that he wasn't overflowing with the ecstasy and exuberance of human existence, which is just a high-class way of saying George was dragging bottom. Naturally, I asked him, "How are you, George?" Now, while that was meant to be a routine inquiry, George took me seriously, and for 15 minutes, he enlightened me on how bad he felt. And the more he talked, the worse I felt. Finally, I said to him, "Well, George, I'm sorry to see that you are in such a depressed state. How'd you get that way?" Well, that really set him off. "It's my problems," he said. "Problems, nothing but problems. I'm fed up with problems. If I could get rid of all my problems, I would contribute $5,000 to your favorite charity." Well, now, I'm never one to turn a deaf ear to such an offer. And so I meditated, ruminated, and cogitated on the proposition and came up with an answer that I thought was pretty good. I said, "Yesterday I went to a place where thousands of people reside. As far as I can determine, not one of them has any problems. Would you like to go there?" "When can we leave? That sounds like my kind of place," answered George. "If that's the case, George," I said, "I'll be happy to take you tomorrow to Woodland Cemetery, because the only people who don't have any problems are dead." And then Ken Blanchard had this to say. I love that story. It really puts life into perspective. I heard Norman say many times, "If you have no problems at all, I warn you, you're in grave jeopardy. You're on your way out and you don't know it. If you don't believe you have any problems, I suggest you immediately race from wherever you are, jump into your car, drive home as fast but as safely as possible, run into your house, go straight to your bedroom, slam the door, then get on your knees and pray, 'What's the matter, Lord? Don't you trust me anymore? Give me some problems.'" Encouragement. It can come from many sources. It can come from a coach, a teacher, a friend. Might come from a word from a parent or a grandparent. Might be an attaboy or an attagirl from a coworker or a supervisor. And it certainly might be from someone. because we are breathing, we are going to have problems. And that's simply the drawback of living life every single day. So this is a reality. So how do we get through it? That's where the church comes in. Remember that definition of church? One about the body of believers? That means us. The encouraging word is found in this definition. The model goes all the way back to the beginning of church itself. Paul begins his letter by giving this body of believers an encouraging word. Life is hard, especially when a little girl wants to come up here. Life is hard, Paul is saying. Life is full of problems, he says. And yes, life must be lived every single day. And to get through it, we have each other. We have the church. And we have the body of believers who know a thing or two about the problems, about difficulties, and about life's situations. Oh, would help if I had this thing on. There we go. And if you're going to get through it, Paul says, you must do what I do. Encourage each other. Let people know that you care. Tell people you'll be there before. It might be a note. It might be a meal. It might be a phone call. It might be, hey, we missed you the other night. But Paul set the standard some 2,000 years ago. And I'm not going to argue with that. I want to end today with a story from Barbara Glenn. She was speaking to about 3,000 employees of a large supermarket chain, and this is what she had to say. One of the ideas I stressed was the importance of adding a personal signature to your work. I think it is essential for each of us to find a way we can really feel good about ourselves and our job. One of the most powerful ways to do this is to do something that differentiates you from the other people that do the same things you do. I shared the example of a United Airlines pilot who, after everything's under control in the cockpit, goes to the computer, randomly selects several people on board the flight, and handwrites them a thank you note for their business. A graphic artist I work with always encloses a piece of sugarless gum in everything he sends to his customers, so you never throw any mail away from him. A Northwest Airlines baggage attendant decided that his personal signature would be to collect all the luggage tags that fall off customer suitcases, which in the past had been simply tossed into the garbage. In his free time, send them back with a note thanking them for flying Northwest. After sharing several other examples of how people add their unique spirit to their jobs, I challenged the audience to get their creative juices flowing and to come up with their own personal signature. About 3 weeks after I had spoken to the supermarket and employees, my phone rang one late afternoon. The person on the line told me that his name was Johnny and that he was a bagger in one of the stores. He also told me that he was a person with Down syndrome. He said, "Barbara, I liked what you said." Then he went on to tell me that he had gone home that night with an idea. Each night when he goes home, he finds a thought for the day. He said that when he can't find one he likes, he thinks one up. Then he types into his computer, prints out the multiple copies, cuts them out, signs his name on the back of each one. The next day, as he's bagging customers' groceries, he puts a thought for the day in each person's groceries, adding his own personal signature in a heartwarming, fun, and creative way. 1 month later, the manager of the store called me. He said, "Barbara, you wouldn't believe what happened today. When I went out on the floor this morning, the line at Johnny's checkout was 3 times longer than any other line. I went ballistic, yelling, 'Get more lines open! Get more people out here!' But the customer said, 'No, no, we want to be in Johnny's lane. We want the thought for the day.'" The manager said, "One woman approached him and said, 'I only used to shop here once a week. Now I come here every time I go by because I want the thought for the day.'" And then the manager ended by saying, "Who do you think is the most important person in our whole store?" "Johnny, of course." 3 months later, he called me again. "You and Johnny have transformed our store. Now in the floor department, when they have a broken flower or an unused corsage, they go out on the floor and find an elderly woman or a little girl to pin it on them. One of the meat packers loves Snoopy, So he bought 50,000 Snoopy stickers. And each time he packages a piece of meat, he puts a Snoopy sticker on it. We are having so much fun, and so are our customers. In a few minutes, you're going to get an invitation. Communion to John Wesley was called a means of grace. Now, as I said, it's just an old English term that today means a love note from God. Or an encouraging word. Or in the words of Barbara Lamb's, our personal signature. As I look out here, you're still breathing. Which means you have problems. Which means you need an encouraging word. What is church? It's a place of encouragement. Amen. I'm going to turn things over to our ushers. This is our opportunity to give back to God, and I want to thank them for their service in our worship service time today.